Good morning, and welcome to Riviera United Methodist Church's Laity Sunday. We are so glad you are joining us here in the sanctuary and online. The United Methodist Church and predecessor Methodist Church has celebrated Laity Sunday since 1929. The laity, or lay members, of the congregations plan the worship service, and it's traditionally on the third Sunday in October. Our Riviera Governance Council planned this service. The ministry of all persons is highlighted, uplifting our vocations as we proclaim the gospel messages. Today, sharing in their messages are, with the theme, My Faith Journey, Rivierans Kate Paulsen, Bruce Attig, Julia Hurd, and Claire Line on video. So please join me as you're able to rise for the call to worship. We come together in body and spirit as a community of faith. We come to praise you, God, for our variety of calls and action. We, a people of faith, are thankful for the various journeys we have been on. Our spiritual growth journey continues as we learn about God and the created world in which we are stewards. Today, we open our ears, eyes, minds, and hearts to absorb the messages of the ways God has touched us. Together, wherever we are, we rejoice in this new week as we walk together, heeding God's call. Amen.
Good morning, and please join in singing our opening hymn. It's number 415 in the United Methodist Hymnal. Take up thy cross, the Savior said. The words are also printed in your bulletin and, of course, on your screen at home.
Passing the peace is a long-established tradition where we express the love, care, and grace of God with our community members. Although we're not shaking hands or hugging, we do want to have a share by waving and acknowledging one another. And our online worshipers, we hope that you will use the chat to greet one another. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Amen.
There we go. Good morning, friends. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Few announcements that I want to make sure we lift up. Some things coming up. This is a month with a fifth Saturday, which means we do have a loaves and fishes meal here on Saturday, October 30th. With ongoing COVID precautions, the outreach ministry is still opting to do kind of a grab and go sort of a meal. So if you want to help sponsor those meals, they cost about $10 each. So you can make donations in $10 increments, either via the church website, via church community builder, a check, and just on your check, make sure that you note that it is for loaves and fishes. A couple other things, if you want to do kind of more direct donations for those grab-and-go meals, they're looking for donations of prepackaged cookies or desserts, chips, crackers, that sort of thing. So if you're interested in donating that sort of thing, you can let Vicki or Andrea know so they can coordinate getting it dropped off here at the church. And so that will be on October 30th. And then All Saints Sunday will be on October 31st. And if you do have a loved one who has died in the past year that you would like us to acknowledge and celebrate in our All Saints service, if you could get a picture to Annie by October 25th, or to the church office, again, by October 25th, so we can make sure that we don't leave anybody out. And then I think Paul McPhee has some stuff he wants to say.
As you guys are aware, I have a lot to say. So, thank you for being seated. Today we are recognizing the amazing employees that work at this church for us, and week in and week out make this service possible and just amazing. So I wanted to first read a quote. Don't ask me who Tammy Cohen is, but I liked the quote. It goes like this: a great employee is like a four-leaf clover, hard to find and lucky to have. I liked that. We are lucky. All of our employees here do an amazing job for us. They're so kind and just hard workers, so we wanted to recognize them today. And not sure if you guys are aware, we have some long-term employees. And for all of you in the industries out there, it's hard to find employees that are long-term and that stick around. So this is something that we're really appreciative of. So I'm gonna call a name, and I would like them to come up here and be recognized for their service to this church and our community. And please stay up here because I want a picture of all these employees too, so Annie can continue working with us and post it on the bulletin or something. So, speaking of Annie, let's have Annie Gom come up here. Annie is stellar. This lady, the director of communications for our church here, has been here for 18 years. So thank you so much, Annie. Let me find your... a little gift from the church to say thank you. Next, we have Dawn Brooks. Dawn's not used to being in front of the microphone, so, you know, she might be nervous coming up to the stage. But Dawn, our director of music ministries...
He's saying it's not time for me to sing right now, so hold on.
Don has been here for 15 years. He can come too. He's part of the team. Bring him up because you know who's coming up next? Cory Johnson. Come on to the floor. Come on now. Organist and rhyme director has been here 14 years as well, almost 15. So thank you guys so much. I mean, I think you guys are lucky that I'm not doing this because I am tone deaf. So I think these two as a team coming up here every single week, it's seriously, it's incredible. Your musicality, like what you guys bring to the table, is really awesome. We really appreciate it. Next, the great Dina Babb, whom has to deal with me way too much because of my kids. Dina, the director of Children and Family Ministries, has been here 9 years, guys. And just from a young family, having Dina around and all that she does, it's just absolutely incredible what she's helped out with the preschool and everything around here. You know, Sunday school, nursery. She really does an amazing job for us, and we appreciate that. I guess I can start handing out gifts. I keep forgetting. And I actually forgot a picture. Annie did get it. Dawn. Here, you can hold this one, too. That's a really cool picture. There we go. Lisa, everybody. Next, a face somebody might not see that often around here, but somebody behind the scenes who is doing a ton of work for us, Tracy Underwood. Tracy is our office manager. You know, I mean, the nicest, never says no type of person. She has been here for 3 years now. So thank you so much, Tracy, for all that you do for us. And then, last but not least, Kelsey Curry, Director of Youth Ministries. Let's build that up, friends, all right? We need more kids. She's been here for actually, I mean, welcome, a full year now, which is insane. So all of this, guys, like just this team up here, guys, just does so much for us. Thank you guys so much for all that you guys do. It's sincerely appreciated. You guys are amazing. You make this church amazing and our community even better. So thank you guys so much. And we got thank you. Lisa, everybody, again. Thank you guys so much. And I'm going to bring back up Dina.
And now, way more entertaining and fun than looking at all of us grown-ups. We get to celebrate a milestone today. This church celebrates several milestones over the year, including a presentation of not children's Bibles, but real grown-up Bibles to our third graders. And we have two third graders in our church community right now. One is not with us today, but I'm pretty sure is watching at home, Julian. But Kevin is here today, so Kevin, you want to come up and join me? And then if the congregation, if you would turn in your bulletins, under where it says presentation of third grade Bibles, I'm gonna need some participation from all of you. We are gifting these Bibles to Kevin and Julian, not from me, not from Pastor Sonny, but from the church, from all of us. And so I wanted everybody to have an opportunity to be included in that. So you will see a congregational blessing under the presentation of third grade Bibles. And for my friends at home, I believe it's on your screen. If you wanna read along at home, I promise you, Kevin can hear you and Julian can hear you. And please join me in the congregational blessing. We hope that as you read the Bible, you will bring not only your faith, but also your questions and your doubts to Riviera UMC. We are here as a loving, supporting, listening, and teaching community. We want to grow with you and faith and knowledge. So Kevin, I'm gonna give you this. Nope, my turn first. And then I'm gonna say to Kevin, receive this sacred text. Learn its stories and study its words. Its stories belong to us all, and these words speak to us all. They tell us who we are. They tell us that we belong to one another, for we are the people of God. And then Kevin's gonna say,
I receive this Bible with my hands, my heart, and my mind. I will read this with curiosity, listen with openness, and I will ask questions in trust. I will grow with you in faith and knowledge.
Great job, Kevin. Can we give a round of applause for my friend Kevin? And then will you join with me, please, in the prayer at the end there. God, we are all a part of the story you are telling. We want our part of it to be full of love and joy and beauty. Amen. Thank you.
All right. We come to our time of sharing our hearts and lives with one another that we might lift them to God in prayer. So I guess I'll run around with the microphone. So if you have a joy or concern, would you raise your hand and I will bring the mic to you. Yes.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, I think Rosemary Zettler celebrated a birthday yesterday. Is that right? 95 years old? Yes, Rosemary, happy birthday. We love you so much. I hope you're watching.
Other raised hands for joys and concerns? Yes.
Oh, goody, you've given me this. My son's getting married on the 23rd, Saturday. About time after 10 years of dating. Yay! Matt's out.
Others.
I know that we've already thanked all our staff, and this Sunday, I haven't been a lifelong Methodist, but I've come to understand being here about the importance of the laity and that the laity is the church. And my heart is just, I just have to say, is just so full of gratitude and love for everyone in this church and for our staff. I mean, just know that we appreciate you much more than whatever you got in those things.
Other joys or concerns? Missing anybody? Okay. Let us continue then by offering our song of preparation. As children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. By the strength of a creative God, through the grace of a loving Christ, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, we join our hearts in prayers this morning. We lift up our hearts in prayer, inviting your presence among us, for us to recognize your nearness, that we might commend to you our lives, our hopes, our fears, and our dreams. We give you thanks for Rosemary and her birthday of 95 years and for Matt's engagement after a number of years. We also give you thanks for the gift of the brothers and sisters around us this morning, laity, friends, servants, staff, that we are in ministry together and that you empower your people to live out our baptism. This morning we commend to you our world and the challenges we face, fires in our communities, floods in other parts of our nation. We ask you to be with people who are affected by each. We give you thanks for those who stand on their behalf, first responders, family, and neighbors. We ask you to be with us in this season of pandemic and the next steps before us. We give you thanks that we have choices, but we are also mindful of people around the world who don't have choices, for whom the vaccine is not yet readily available. And we ask for the will of your people to respond, to be mindful of them, and provide so that all your children might be well. We're also mindful in our neighborhoods and our communities, even in Southern California, of the dislocated of our world. Dislocated people who are exiles, migrants, those who suffer from mental illness, people who are self-medicating, the dislodged due to illness. We ask you to be among us as we feel overwhelmed by the homelessness of your children. Provide for us motivation. Provide for us spirit. Provide for us heart that we might respond to your children in ways that empower and equip them, in ways that draw us together as community to respond to the very challenging circumstances in which we find ourselves. O Lord, all of this we commend to you with great thanksgiving for all that you have already done for us, for your presence in our midst, your grace which overcomes our brokenness, your hope which overcomes our fears. Bless and strengthen us for the road ahead. All this we commend to you in the spirit of your Son, for in his name we pray. Amen.
Hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Incline thine ear to us and grant us thy peace. Hear our prayer.
Many of you know, I've been going to this church since I was in the womb. So I was asked to kind of talk about my faith journey, and I grew up going to church here, and in high school I also went to Rolling Hills Covenant, and through both here and there I came to kind of find my own faith and my own relationship with God, and I'm very much of a doer, so I started Bible studies, got more involved, and was very involved in church and my faith in high school. So when I went to college, I was like really eager to get involved in the faith communities there, and I went to Bowdoin all the way in Maine. I like to say I accidentally went as far as I could in the continental U.S. Wasn't my intention. And there I got really involved in a Christian fellowship and again took on leadership roles and really, really loved being part of that faith community. However, when I was at Bowdoin, there was also some disagreements, as in many areas of the church today, on what is the role in Christianity, particularly related to a lot of social issues. And so I ultimately had to kind of separate from this, the only faith community on at Bowdoin campus, because of just disagreements with kind of what my role as a leader is and what I see as the role of a Christian. And that was a really painful loss because I felt like I didn't have a community. I felt like I didn't have a place to turn. And I remember the summer before my junior year of, summer before my senior year of college, I remember just being in a church service and like writing down on some little scratch paper that they gave us and saying, like, I need a mentor, like, I need a spiritual mentor I can trust. And a week later, I met this amazing family through Bowden, who was actually a professor and his wife, and I got to know them a little bit more. And then later on in the year, I was thinking, like, I have these people in my life, but I really need a community. And then the next day at church, they asked, do you want to come over with a group of other students every Saturday and have dinner with us in a Bible study? And overall, those experiences kind of showed me the way that God can work through even what I saw as a loss, but he really came through for me in ways that those two prayers were answered so quickly and in such a loving environment that I think I grew so much just it was always a breakfast for dinner and just talking with them about what the role of faith in our lives is as students and in our future, and just playing with their kids, and I'll forever be grateful for the way God intervened in my life then. So then I came back from Maine to Los Angeles, and I was in medical school and again got involved in faith communities and a church up in Culver City as well. It's a lot closer, it's a little hard to commute here on a regular basis from Westwood. And again, I really enjoyed the community there, but I think some of the greatest growth for me this past few years with many people in the pandemic, it's been a time of loss, a time of grieving. I lost also my grandpa last year and had to kind of deal with grief and sadness for the first time. And then I was also in my third year of medical school where I was doing rotations and seeing a lot of loss, seeing death, and seeing just tragedy. And I really had to learn to, instead, I'm very much of a doer, a starting Bible studies, a participation, but really also looking inward and building my relationship with God on a more personal level. And so it's been a lot of time of self-reflection and just getting to know, taking that quiet time with God. And I've just kind of seen, I'm still on the younger side, how like faith ebbs and flows and you never know kind of where your journey is going to go. And when I look to my future, I'm interested in pediatrics, but I'm interested in an area of pediatrics that most people don't really know exists, pediatric palliative care. So it's supporting kids who are both at their most difficult moments and supporting families, and I really feel like it's God is kind of calling me toward that. And this idea of even if you can't cure, you can always heal, you can always alleviate suffering, and I feel like that's so much of what Jesus's message was about, bringing comfort. And there's this one verse in Philippians 4, 6 through 7, do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And I think with so much of the difficulties, so much of the anxiety and stress of life in general, and then also with this career path I might have going forward, I really see that I can always pray, regardless for everyone, for God's peace and comfort, and knowing that he's always there, even if I don't feel him in that moment, but I can always look to God for both myself, for my patients, and I'm just really grateful to have had this community here and just to find so many other faith communities in my future. And so thank you all for always being there for me throughout the years. So that's all.
Good morning, I'm Bruce Attig. This was an interesting exercise for me because instead of doing what I would typically do of just getting up and speaking extemporaneously, I realized that I go down a lot of different paths unless I have a script to go off of, so I'm gonna let you, if you'll indulge me. So as part of my faith journey, as many of you know, I grew up in a family of farmers and preachers, so it was in my DNA. It had me either feeling guilty for not adequately demonstrating my faith in public settings, to not focusing sufficiently on the pastor's sermons during church. Outside of the occasional Holy Spirit endorphins that I would receive by attending church camp as a youth, I really didn't have any significant born-again moments. I'm not aware of any time that my spiritual faith was challenged as a result of emotional or physical loss. And church attendance had always just been a central part of my life. Even in my early college years, I was always looking for friends to go to attend worship services with me. In fact, my first elected office in college was as chaplain of the house. When it comes to testing my faith, my wife often reminds me of the times that I had first started my career in Chicago. I moved there shortly after college. I left behind the family farm, but staying on the farm really wasn't an option. The farm barely sustained my parents, my three natural siblings, and numerous foster children. So I sought work in the big city of Chicago. I was without a savings, carrying a substantial student loan, and very aware that there was no fallback provision, which really helped to strengthen my resolve. I worked a series of odd jobs downtown until I finally found a working combination that would try to advance me towards a career. So for my time at work up there, the first part of my days were spent on the floor of the Chicago Board of Options Exchange, usually from about 6:30 in the morning until about 3. I was given a stipend of about $1,000 a month, but fortunately, in the mornings at the exchange, they set out donuts on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, and bagels on Tuesdays and Thursdays. So if I grabbed 2, I'd have breakfast and I'd have lunch. In the latter part of the day, I got a job working in an upscale health club, which worked out great for me because I was working as a waiter and I was able to work out in their gym between shifts, and I got one decent meal every day. Most nights I was finished by 11 p.m., so I was hopefully back on the train and back to my apartment by midnight so I could start it all again the next morning. Most mornings I had enough change in my pocket to take the train back down to Chicago's downtown. But there were more than a few lean days of needing to allow extra time to walk the 4 miles to get back to the exchange in time for work. This also played a crucial role in my early faith-giving philosophy. If it came to deciding between putting a dollar in the offering plate on Sunday morning or holding that for the bus meter on Monday, I just thanked God that my legs worked fine. In fact, one of the biggest challenges I had with this life was on Sundays. I was raised with the understanding that Sunday was to be dedicated to God. On the farm, when we were ever behind schedule, we would only work until midnight on Saturday night. And then my dad would set the alarm for Monday morning at 1 o'clock to get started again. I thought it was kind of silly at the time, but in retrospect, I now realize that there was one safeguard that I had in life, and that was during my Sunday's time. So the big difference with working in Chicago was that I didn't have that option of not working on Sundays, nor did I have the option of not working through holidays, which really depressed me. One day, on a despondent weekend walk down in Chicago's Loop, I found myself wandering and wondering where my life was going and why I had left the comfort of rural America for this chaotic lifestyle. That was when I looked up and saw the beautiful Chicago Temple. It's a 21-story building in downtown Chicago amidst all the high-rises with 148 tall-foot spire. The first floor of this housed the First United Methodist Church of Chicago, which had been in that same location since 1838. I probably had not attended church for a few weeks and desperately wanted a connection with God in a house of worship. I walked into the first floor sanctuary and was immediately consumed by the feeling of warmth and purpose. I had never been in there before, but it felt like that's where I was directed to be. My chest loosened and I could barely breathe, but now I was starting to be able to breathe more freely. I sat down in the rear pew and just prayed. I know that connecting with God in a church isn't any better than elsewhere, but the experience let me know that wherever I go, God will be there. I just needed to get out of my own head. Shortly after that, I was blessed to have another major life-changing event on New Year's Eve, where I met my wife, Lynn. At the time, I was just starting to become mature enough to really appreciate her. One of my greatest treasures was growing in a relationship with someone who held similar ideals and strengthened me to become a more complete person. I know this is not the end of the story. Trials and tribulations will always be part of life, but how I respond is what makes me who I am in my faith journey. And in reference to this, we were asked to do a Bible verse. And whenever I'm looking for comfort or looking for direction, I always often turn to the book of James. And James 2, is on the subject of trials and tribulations. It says, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do." Thank you.
I feel honored to be on the same platform with these wonderful speakers, starting with our wonderful youth and the third graders, and going on up to, well, I guess up to me. And so it's a wonderful experience, and I thank you all for your messages. I have to say, I'm a Southern Belle at heart. Believe it or not, I was born in Little Rock, Arkansas in 1937. I soon had a little sister. We were a wonderful family. But when I was 5 years old, my father moved to Indianapolis, Indiana, for his job as an engineer. So I grew up a Midwesterner. I was raised in the Baptist Church. My paternal grandmother was an artist. She painted a beautiful scene of the River Jordan, which hung over the altar in her church. My other grandmother played the piano for hymn sings. My father often quoted the Bible. He used to say, "Every story that's ever been told was told first in the Bible." We went to church every Sunday morning and often again in the evening for a hymn sing and fellowship. Then there were the Wednesday night potlucks, the Bible study groups, the children's after-school activities. My father had played football at the University of Arkansas, so he coached the church sports teams. Believe it or not, the churches had sports teams. It was baseball in the summer and basketball in the winter. Of course, it was Indiana. It had to be basketball. So my sister and I were the team mascots. I was baptized at the age of 8. This was considered the age of reason, where you could make a decision for yourself. That may sound young, but it meant a lot to me at the time. We had a preparation class, and you had to state publicly that you felt you were ready for your baptism. I was fully immersed in the baptistry, which was a section of the church with this built in. And when I rose up out of that water, I can tell you that is an experience, and I felt very blessed. Most children went to church, all my little playmates. So you had groups of friendships. You had your school and neighborhood playmates, and you had your church playmates. Even school teachers often wrote a Bible verse on the blackboard, such as "Love your neighbor." That wouldn't be accepted now, but it was then. We often had missionaries in the church. And I love to hear these exotic stories of colorful lands and people who needed to hear about Jesus and needed schools and hospitals. And I would throw a few coins from my allowance into the basket. As I got into my late teens, though, I started wondering, are some of these Bible stories really true? What does this mean? Are they really miracles? I kind of wondered what were the deeper meanings of these stories, but I didn't know who to ask. When I was in college, I always went to the Baptist Youth Fellowship on Sunday evenings because they served supper and the dorms didn't serve supper Sunday night. But I decided to visit other churches for the Sunday morning service, and I thought that was very daring of me because I had never been to anything but a Baptist church. Jim and I graduated together from Purdue University. We were married by that time and headed to California for Jim's new job at Hughes Aircraft with a 6-week-old baby. And 3 others followed pretty soon after that. So we're looking for a church, and Jim was raised in the Methodist church, so that was fine with me. But again, I felt a little bit daring. So we joined Hawthorne Methodist, not United. It was just Hawthorne Methodist at that time. We were attracted by the liberal atmosphere and a great music program. We had very liberal Bible studies that gave me a new understanding of the Holy Writ. We had exchanges with a Jewish congregation, actively supported the Fair Housing Campaign, the Cesar Chavez Movement for Farm Workers. We had a weekend conference on homosexuality and other causes which truthfully had not been on my radar before. I saw how God's people could work together to change the world. And I received an appointment to a brand new committee in the Methodist Church, the Commission on the Status and Rights of Women. And I'm pleased today to see that we have, along with our wonderful men pastors, we have many women pastors. But we did have a major event while we were at the Hawthorne Church. That was the receiving of Vietnamese refugees at the fall of Saigon. We had an emergency meeting in April 1975 to prepare us. What happened was one of our church board members was associated with Flying Tiger Airlines. And Flying Tiger, just before the invasion by the Viet Cong, airlifted 75 Vietnamese. Many were families with children. And they were brought to our airport, and they were coming to our church for help. This was very short notice, and this was before any type of government programs, camps, reception centers. It was just us with these 75 people and many children. So we immediately all rushed to the church. We took clothing. They found housing for these people in some houses that had been condemned for airport expansion, and they were able to live there. But we had no time to shop or do anything, so we took our own things, our extra sheets, our pots and pans, you know, food that we happened to have in the house. It was very sudden, so you really had the feeling that you were, you know, reaching out to someone. And I've always connected this time with the biblical message, welcome the stranger, for you were once a stranger in a strange land. Our own church program was quickly taken over by Church World Service and lasted for several years to assist the refugees. We were able to visit Vietnam later and found it a beautiful and friendly country many years after the war. I'm grateful that Jim and I have been able to travel quite a bit, which started with his work travel. So we visited a lot of countries in Europe and so forth, with the help of church friends who often to babysit our four children. As much as we enjoyed visiting more familiar countries, we kind of wanted to explore new territory, and the Near East in particular appealed to us. When we were in Egypt, we could picture the wanderings of Abraham in the sands of Egypt. We envisioned the infant Moses rescued out of the shimmering water of the Blue Nile. On the walls of Coptic churches, we saw paintings and mosaics of Mary riding on a donkey, carrying baby Jesus and led by Joseph. The Egyptians take pride in having saved the infant Christ from the deadly wrath of King Herod. And Muslims, we are told, revere Jesus as a prophet. We had long thought of visiting Israel, but, you know, there was always a lot of violence there, and we weren't sure, but finally we decided to just do it. Our tour guide called himself a Jerusalem-born Palestinian. He spoke several languages and seemed to know everyone we passed, and he had both Israeli and Muslim friends. The streets of old Jerusalem are filled with a colorful array of citizens, visitors from every part of the world, pilgrims who may suddenly fall to their knees to pray or sing, conservative Jews in traditional clothing, children at play, vendors of all kinds. That was quite a sight, and we were thrilled to approach the Western Wall and leave our prayers and messages. Israel had a more varied appearance and type of living than we thought. Tel Aviv is a large modern city with on a beach lined with luxury hotels. We thought the countryside would be all desert, but there were national parks with natural beauty, animal sanctuaries, and hiking trails. One thing that was disturbing, whenever there were groups of school children playing in the park or hiking in the mountains, they were always accompanied by armed guards. Jewish laws are observed. If you have spaghetti and meatballs for dinner, you won't get any Parmesan cheese. You don't mix milk and meat. There's no omelet at the Sabbath breakfast. That would be work for the person who did the cooking. And there was a Shabbat elevator. That is, it stops automatically at every floor, so that on the Sabbath, you would not have to push a button. There are churches built over many sites associated with Jesus, so they no longer looked as if they might in Jesus' day. But we did walk through the Garden of Gethsemane. We dipped our hands in the River Jordan and bought a bottle of river water in the gift shop. Most moving is the Via Dolorosa, part of our Savior's last walk through the Old City. It was exciting to visit the desert site where the Dead Sea Scrolls were found. The Dead Sea itself, it sounds like it would be unattractive, but it's beautiful, sparkling, light blue water, and now is a resort with hotels. The most dramatic place is Masada. This was the high fortress built by King Herod where the last battle between the Jews and Romans was fought. The last Jewish defendants took their own lives rather than surrender. Israeli soldiers are still brought there for their induction. As our children grew older, we became interested in Riviera, now United Methodist Church. We had friends here. We were familiar with the excellent music program with David Wilson, which I'm happy to say is still carried out by our own Don and Cory. And we were delighted to discover that George Zettler was also with Flying Tigers and knew our friend at Hawthorne Church. We have been very happy here making new friends and experienced excellent study groups, marvelous pastors. I feel I have learned something from every pastor I have ever had. Some people say, oh, I like this one or not that one. I love them all. They all have a message to bring, and I love to hear that. And we are happy that the church offers opportunities to aid other people, such as our involvement with the Toberman Center and our loaves and fishes meals for needy people. We are so glad to be part of this congregation and have friends here and wish you all blessings. And I'd like to close with a quote from Psalm 18. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust.
When I think about my faith journey, something that stands out to me is how amazed I am by God's creative power. Perhaps Psalm 104:24-25 says it best. How many are your works, Lord? In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. There is the sea, vast and spacious, teeming with creatures beyond number, living things, both large and small. My favorite hymn, How Great Thou Art, shares a similar message. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made. When life gets hard, I know that many of us can begin to wonder where God has gone. When bad things happen, it's easy to feel alone and to lose sight of the world God has made. So many bad things have been happening lately. Tumultuous politics and a pandemic, to name a couple. But when I go out in nature, I'm reminded of how wonderful God's power is. I think of him when I see mountains turning a majestic purple at dusk. I think of him when I hear ocean waves crash. I even think of him when I see a variety of interesting creatures living together in tide pools. Tiny crabs, anemones, fish, and so many more thriving in the water's ebb and flow. As I journey through life, my faith becomes stronger when I take time to appreciate the world around me. How great thou art.
Thank you so much to all our lay speakers. That was wonderful. And now for the offering. Our offering is about responding to God's love and grace with the gifts of our own lives. Today we invite you to respond to God's love with your whole heart, your life, and your gifts. We won't be passing a plate through the aisles, but if you'd like to make a gift today, you can use the QR code found in the back of the pew to link on to our online giving, or you can drop an offering of a check or cash in the box in the lobby. Thank you.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far from safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign. Shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid. I go before you always. Come, follow me. If you pass through raging waters in the sea, you shall not drown. If you walk amid the burning flames, you shall not be harmed. If you stand before blessed are you.
please join me in prayer. Generous God, over and over your grace sustains us. Over and over your love provides for us. Over and over your arm steadies us. We give you these gifts with gratitude and joy, thankful that you are God over all. Amen.
I invite you to join in singing our closing hymn. It's in the smaller faith we sing, hymnal number 2242, Walk With Me, and the words are in your bulletin and, of course, on your screen at home. Number 2242.
Received words of encouragement from your fellow leaders in the life of the church and ministry. You have received the proclamation of God's words and songs that encourage you to walk together in the company of Christ. Now go forward in peace to live out that life, joined arm in arm, hand in hand, and spirit in spirit. Go into the world and serve the Lord with gladness. Amen.